this is. Good afternoon to all of you. I want you to welcome Mandira Datta. Mandira, this is our Bengali pronunciation, is Mandira Datta, not Mandira Datta. She happens to be a very, very old friend of mine, 2 years senior to me from IIMCAT. But it's kind of beyond that, because when I first came to Bombay in 73, and I didn't know anybody else, I think Mandira was the first person I really came to know, to the extent that, see, those days, by the 10th of the month, I was broke. So from the 11th to the end of the month, she fed. Hey, all that personal thing apart, she's a Vida IC's from a schooling from Lamartinia in Kolkata. Did a college in Delhi Bhubon with a BA in English Honours. Then went to IIM Calcutta, sixth batch in 1971. Then for some time, from 1971 to 1980, she worked in a company called Home Products India Limited. The Home Products India, which is now defunct, for many, many years used to be the most important competitor that Hindustan Unilever had. His Home Products had brands, which some of them are, at least in racial memory terms, I mean, certainly your parents would remember many of those brands. Sway, I think, was one.
Sway did that.
Yes. They were the most serious competitor in Hindustan Unilever. P&G, frankly, at that point in time was called, which was a Hindustan. They were minor, they were serious in minor care. 1980 odd is when the entrepreneurship bug bit Mandira. She started on her own. She promoted a company called Crisclear. She's going to talk about that. Then in 1994, she started a company called Mother's Touch, which she's again going to talk about. And essentially, she's going to talk about what are the things that she's learned after being a practicing entrepreneur with some degree of success and some degree of failure as well. She's a practicing yoga. She's been practicing yoga and learned from D.K. Iyengar for many years. And she's now a trained teacher. She specializes in teaching yoga for particular people with some kind of a disability or the other. And at any point in time, for example, if you wish to talk to her more about yoga itself, I'm sure offline there will be most happy for that. So I want you to welcome her. Mandira, don't worry about this because there are enough people, two students will be happy to help you in terms of slide change and so on.
No, you said, I think I'll manage. If I need help, I'll ask.
Yeah, Aditya, I think you need to help her to go one slide back because I think you already skipped a slide.
Just press the number. doesn't go up. Well, you've heard Yantra already telling you. You can hear me right at the back?
Yes.
About my background and what you're going to be getting. So it is a tale of an entrepreneur, and I like to put it as a narration. Sometimes I will say she, because it's been a long time, okay? Since 71 I've been starting off from. And I would like you all to also be participative in this discussion that I'm going to be narrating, and tell me where we could have made some different choices, etc. This is just an exploration of the experiences that I will be narrating. So, I'm starting off. This is the title, Tale of a Failed Entrepreneur, but so far. Okay? So, I haven't given up, and if I don't have this happening, it will be difficult for us to see it clearly and narrate to you the experiences to the best of my ability, as honestly as I can. It's difficult, you know, to own up to mistakes, but we'll try. I left IIM and I joined a company, as you said, Home Products Division, which was a part of the Sarabhai group of companies. You would have heard about Vikram Sarabhai, yes. The company. Yes. He had actually founded this detergents and soap business, and they also marketed and manufactured Max Factor cosmetics. So when I joined, there were very few women in those days, you know, working in business. And when I joined, I was given immediately a staff job. You know what's a staff job? Yeah, there is, it's like a flat thing. And I was always the one to want to do things. A staff job was sitting behind a desk, and it seemed boring. I wasn't very brave with numbers, and I always associated with market research, etc., which was not my area of interest. I was expecting to do a line job, you know. I wanted to go into marketing, and marketing those days meant only distribution. There wasn't much of product management. Yes, there was little advertising, but it hasn't developed the way it has now. Products were not available. The first thing was the products had to be available. So when I joined them, my marketing executive or marketing director, he saw my dismay, and he first offered me Max Factor, thinking that was the long job, and I always enjoyed dressing up, as you can still see. You know, would be the one interested in Max Factor cosmetics. But to me, that was not the area, because that I knew was a subsidiary, and it was not mainline business, okay? So then he said, all right, we are having, the company was now in the growth phase. So from 120 sales force, they were going up to 450 and ultimately 600. So he said, why don't you handle this? It was very exciting to be able to, those days we didn't travel on work as we did, and there, because I had to travel everywhere, I was flying all over the place. I mean, it was like, you know, now if you get a job and you fly all over the world, you know, it was that level of excitement. So anyway, not only that, I worked out the whole plan of how the whole India was involved. So how worked out the geographical and all the, how we will be placing people in different parts of the country. And we had regional offices in Delhi, Calcutta, Chennai, which was Madras and Bombay. So I went there to, you know, know, some of them I can't see. You know, this is very disturbing. Because of this thing.
That
so if some of you can come here who are hidden, especially those people, it would be nice. You know, I just saw your face. You know, these people, you could come up front. I want to share and I want your input also. So, this took time and it was successfully instituted. By that time, I got to know all the people. The regional managers were very important because they got the business. So, and right through, everybody was known to me. But I got the feeling, distinct feeling, that I said, look here, let me get trained up now into be a salesman. Give me an induction into doing the sales so that I get to learn. Anyway, they gave me, I think, 2-3 weeks, but with the help of some other salesman to escort me. So that was done. The sales force was set up. So we needed so many in within 9 months, we needed a training. So the next thing is, why don't you make a project for a training center? So first, a couple of training groups. I myself worked on the training. In the meantime, there was Beecham's, which was an agency line, okay? With Beecham's, which made Brill Cream, also Horlicks. But Horlicks, they were distributing themselves. The toiletries, they asked us to distribute. And I would be in charge of that. There was not much work to be done, but we made sure. There, I got exposed to international sales training because Beecham's international trainers came down and trained us. So that was very exciting. So I proposed, can we have a training for these people? And I used that to great advantage. Here, when I was training, a gentleman who was head of personnel, as HR was called in those days, also helped in putting together the context factors, whereas I took care of the content. And we first 3-4, I can't remember how many sessions we took with them at different levels, the regional managers, the sales executives, you know, up to the sales rep. No, we didn't train the sales rep. There were too many of them, mainly up to the first 2 levels, okay? And then, so we got into this nice working relationship. Then again, you know, that was done. We appointed consultants to take care of this training because, you know, then what next? So by that time, the Green Revolution had started. The milk floods had begun. And the rural potential had started dawning in this country. It was a vast market and it was like another country, okay? Because there was such a distinct difference between the urban and the rural. Weavers reached there, but through their wholesale market. They had their bars, soap bars, with that and Lifebuoy, of course. So I made this proposal. Since I was somehow not being given a line function, I made this proposal and it was well accepted. So we got these few couple of trucks or, you know, vans which could carry goods, and we started. I remember one of them, we went to this Gaya Shahabad district, full loaded. 6 in the morning, and we came back at 10 at night. And you know what we sold? It was only 140 rupees. It was 60,000 rupees worth of stocks in there, and 140. We went there, beautiful stores, clean shelves, but they said, no, go. You'll come when there is excess in the urban market, and you dump us with it, and then you'll go away, you disappear. So, that was how it was. But 6 months later, 4 trips after, we were selling anywhere between 25,000 to 30,000 and climbed up to much more later. And main thing is